The distress of those days, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. The stars will fall from the sky and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. At that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all the nations of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory, and he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call, and they will gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heavens to the other. All right, you guys, we are talking about Revelation, specifically the moon of blood, the final witness of the church. Okay, so we've spent a couple of weeks getting our hearts prepared for what God is going to show us in the scriptures. We do have those available on video on demand. If you didn't see them, I recommend that you go back and watch them. Our goal here is not to, you know, have a comprehensive study of everything that's in the book of Revelation, but what God's goal here is tonight and in the weeks to come is to teach you what you need to know about your role in the end times, to give you peace in it, to give you courage, to give you encouragement, and to give you the information that you need to keep you safe from the great delusion or deception that is now settling upon the earth, that was prophesied in the scriptures, which God sends to people who reject the truth. The information that we're going to be putting out is very important because it's going to help you to have the tools to keep your spirit in check, to keep it lined up with the word of God, to look at what's really going on in your heart so that you won't be deceived, so that you won't take the mark of the beast, so that you will not bow down to the spirit of Antichrist. Whenever we are reading scripture, and especially when you're talking about something that is a mystery in scripture, it's very important to follow the rules that God gave us as to how we handle the holy word of God. Okay. Number one, he said, do not add to my words or I will rebuke you and prove you a liar. Actually says, do not add to his words or he will rebuke you and prove you a liar. Second of all, it says, do not take away from his words. And specifically, it says that at the end of the book of Revelation, it says, I warn everyone who hears the word of the prophecy of this book. If anyone adds anything to them, God will add to him the plagues described in this book. And if anyone takes words away from this book of prophecy, God will take away from his share in the tree of life and in the holy city, which are described in this book. So specifically when you're talking about Revelation, don't add to his words. Don't take away from his words, okay? And when you're talking about mysteries like Revelation, don't try to make it make sense, because what you're going to end up doing is trying to fit a square peg in a round hole somewhere, okay? As humans, we really want things to make sense. And when we think we found a key to unlock something, then we want to try to make it fit everywhere in scripture. That's just human nature, okay? But you got to identify that and you got to just stop. If you think that you see a contradiction in scripture, don't try to explain it. Just keep reading the Bible. God will show you what you need to unravel that so that you understand how the scriptures work together and the fact that God's word is perfect. But don't try to make it fit together by diminishing one scripture, throwing it out or saying it doesn't mean what it says, right? Or adding words to try to explain what God was trying to say. Okay, we don't do that to God. We respect God's word and we understand that our mind is small. We are little children, and if we will sit back humbly and simply make it our goal to obey the simple things that God wants us to do, then he will lead us step by step into wisdom. Understand, knowledge is not the same thing as wisdom, and you don't get knowledge the same way. Knowledge will make you proud. Wisdom will bring you to a place of humility and weakness so that you have to depend on God, so that you fear God. And so wisdom is not going to tell you everything that there is to know. By design, wisdom is going to get you to a place where you know that the most important thing that you can do is respect God's words, even if you don't understand them, and show that respect by obeying them. That's called the fear of the Lord. Okay. So wisdom's going to bring you to a place where you don't understand everything, but you obey anyway. When you are contrite and humble enough to do that, then wisdom can pour out her heart to you. She said, if you had responded to my rebuke, I would have poured my heart out to you. Okay? And the Bible says that it's wisdom. It takes a mind of wisdom to unlock these things in the book of Revelation, like the mark of the beast and stuff like that. So understand what God is going to do is he's not going to tell you everything. He's not going to give you the map and say, okay, this is everything, all the information. I'm giving you it all, everything on a silver platter, because he knows that what we will do if we have a map, then we'll say, okay, God, see you there. Right? Because we don't want to have to trust God. We want to be able to do it ourselves. So give me all the information and I'll get there. God knows that's your nature. Okay? So don't be upset when you don't understand stuff. He brings you to that place on purpose. And what you need to be looking at is not, how do I make this make sense? Or, how can I get all the information about it? But what you need to do is simply do what he said. You'll be blessed if you read it, if you listen to it, and if you take it to heart. Okay? Taking it to heart means you're going to take action on it. Right? So what you need to do is what you can understand today, the understanding that God has given to you today that is not disputable, not questionable, not maybe, but for sure, you need to obey that today. Yesterday doesn't matter. Neither does tomorrow. God said today is the day of salvation. Paul said, this thing I do, I don't consider myself to have already attained it, but I forget everything that lies behind and I press forward towards the goal. Okay, he was pressing towards the goal of Jesus Christ for that which God had taken hold of him. He wanted to take hold of Christ. Okay, so you forget yesterday. You don't worry about, maybe you did great yesterday, maybe you didn't. It doesn't matter. God has forgiveness and grace for what how you messed up. And he doesn't want you taking pride in your righteous acts. He wants you today to understand that today is the day of salvation. And if you hear his voice today, don't harden your heart. Okay? Don't think, I'll obey tomorrow. I'll obey next week or at the end of my life. Today, in the small things. God said that the people who are faithful in the small things, they will be faithful in the great things. You can entrust them with everything if you can trust them with the little. So what God has given you today, we're talking about practical things like how you treat your wife, how you treat your husband, how you treat your kids and your mom and your dad, your friends and your enemies, right? In your life today, how you treat your coworkers, whether or not you have integrity, how you relate to money. Okay, do you give it away or do you hoard it? Do you do what you have to do to step on other people's head to get position in your job? All of these things, these decisions that you make today, these are the things that matter, okay? And these are the things that matter going forward in the book of Revelation. So let's arm ourselves with that attitude and understand God's going to show you your purpose, okay? He's going to start doing that tonight. But you apply it today, okay? He's going to show you some things that are going to be happening in the future, some persecution and stuff. If you're not currently experiencing that persecution today, what you need to do is obey God in what you have today. Thank God for what you have today. If you see a hard time coming, say, hey, you know, when it comes, God will give me the strength to do it. But today, I have this and this and this to thank God for, to praise God for. And what you're going to find is if that's your habit, then when you are in prison, when you are in line to be beheaded, when these things do begin to happen to, yes, even you Americans, okay, when that begins to happen, it will be your habit to praise God, to go to God right now today and ask him for strength. And you will know how you will get through it because this will be your practice. This will be your character and this will be your relationship with God. So that's why God is coming to you right now. And that's why what you do today is what is so important. Don't worry about tomorrow. Jesus said that. But today, lay all your cares at his feet. And then he is the one who's going to give you a peace that passes all understanding. Okay, are you guys ready? Here we go. We're going to decode a couple things in the book of Revelation. We don't do it by adding our words or explanations. We just go to the Bible and find the key. You know, like every map has a key that tells you this is what this symbol means. This is what that symbol means. You have to find that in the Bible. Okay? You can't just make stuff up. Say, well, I think that this is an analogy that's talking about this because it seems like it's the same kind of relationships. You can't do that, you guys. Okay, it may look like it fits, but what's going to happen is it looks like it kind of fits over here, but then you're going to find over here it doesn't exactly fit, but now you're invested in this theory that you've started to create, so you're going to start to twist scripture a little bit or ignore scriptures. Just don't go there, okay? We only decode the symbols in the Bible using scripture verses, okay? So here we go. What does the sun and the moon and the stars have to do with anything? Okay, just read the scripture to you where Jesus is talking about the fact that immediately after the distress of those days, the sun's going to be darkened. The moon will not give its light. So here it tells us about a time when neither the sun or the moon is going to give its light. okay? And then the stars will fall from the sky. So he's telling us there are going to be signs in heaven. What you need to understand about signs is that they point to something else. They can be signs of the times, but scripture will tell us if there's more that sign is pointing us to, okay? And in this case, that is certainly the case. The purpose of a sign is to point us to something else. God is pointing us to our purpose, okay? And the culmination of this whole story when he tells us about the sun and the moon. Okay, we're not going to talk that much about the stars. You can look up the stars in your Bible and see what you can find out. It's kind of interesting. But we're going to focus on the sun and the moon tonight so we can find out what this moon of blood is all about and why it says the moon will not give its light. First of all, let's start with the sun. We see Jesus described as the rising sun in this prophecy of Zechariah. Zechariah was John's dad, John the Baptist's dad, and the Holy Spirit came on him and he prophesied about his son, John the Baptist, and he said this, "And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High, for you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him." This is talking about John the Baptist, okay? "To give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace." So he's saying, hey, John, you're going to be preparing the way for this great light, this rising sun that is going to come from heaven to shine on those of us living in darkness. And then we see in John chapter 1 that John the Baptist's testimony was about this light. And let's read again what John the Baptist had to say when he was grown up about this light, this rising sun, as it says, which will come to us from heaven. This is Jesus Christ. It says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it." Okay, so this light is Jesus Christ. It's the Word of God. "There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world." I want you to notice that it says he himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. Remember that word witness, okay? So the true light, the sun, the rising sun that came down from heaven, that's Jesus Christ, according to the scriptures. So whenever you see the sun, understand the scripture says that Jesus Christ is the rising sun. Scripture also compares the sun to a bridegroom. It says the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day, they pour forth speech. Night after night, they display knowledge. There is no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their voice goes out into all the earth, and their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens, he has pitched a tent for the sun, which is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens. Nothing is hidden from its heat. So here it says that the sun is like a bridegroom coming forth from his pavilion, or like a champion rejoicing to run his course. So that's interesting, being that we're told that Jesus Christ is the rising sun. It says that the sun is a bridegroom and a champion. We see that that applies to Christ as well. So the sun is Jesus, is a bridegroom, according to Psalm 19. And in the NET, again, it says, "In the sky, he has pitched a tent for the sun. Like a bridegroom, it emerges from its chamber. Like a strong man, it enjoys running its course." Okay, so according to scripture, Jesus Christ equals the sun, equals a bridegroom. Again, I'm going to show you the scriptures that say Jesus is a bridegroom. This scripture said that the sun is like a bridegroom. Matthew 9:15 tells us, "Jesus answered, how can the guests of the bridegroom mourn while he is with them? The time will come when the bridegroom will be taken from them. Then they will fast." So we see he's calling himself the bridegroom. John 3:28-30 says, "You yourselves can testify that I said, I am not the Christ, but am sent ahead of him. The bride belongs to the bridegroom. The friend who attends the bridegroom waits and listens for him and is full of joy when he hears the bridegroom's voice. That joy is mine, and it is now complete. He must become greater, I must become less." So this is John's testimony that Jesus is the bridegroom and that his people are his bride. So here you see the sun is equated with a bridegroom. The sun is equated with Jesus Christ, as he's called the rising sun, right, in that prophecy, and the light that came into the world. This symbolism is being unlocked for us. When it's talking about the sun, we're talking about Jesus Christ. Okay, now some of you are probably saying, okay, does that mean that the sun and the moon are not literally going to go dark? No, it says they're going to go dark. Okay, So we're not negating that by saying that there's also more meaning to it than that. I'm showing you tonight what the scripture says about the meaning behind that sign. Because remember, when God gives you a sign in the heavens, yeah, that's actually, I mean, it says it's going to happen. It's going to happen. Nothing can stop that. But he gives that as a sign. Signs point to something else. Okay? So understand, he's showing us tonight what that sign means. Yeah, it will actually happen. Okay? In physical life. But it also has another meaning, and that's what we're looking at. Scripture tells us about the purpose and relationship of the sun and the moon. Genesis 1:16 through 18 says, God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. God set them in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth, to govern the day and the night, and to separate light from darkness. And God saw that it was good. Okay, so the purposes of these two great lights, the sun and the moon, that's what we're talking about tonight in the prophecies. The purposes are to rule or to govern the day and the night, okay, to give light to the earth and to separate light from darkness, okay? And then Psalm 136, 7 through 9 again says, to the one who made the great lights, for his loyal love endures, the sun to rule by day, for his loyal love endures, the moon and stars to rule by night, for his loyal love endures. So we see that the sun and the moon are portrayed as being rulers, okay, governing the day and the night. Number two, scripture tells us that as the church or the bride of Christ, just like the moon is appointed to rule with the sun, we are appointed to rule with Christ. Revelation says, to him who overcomes, this is Jesus talking, I will give the right to sit with me on my throne, just as I overcame and sat down with my Father on his throne. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And Luke 22, 28 through 30 says, Jesus is talking to his disciples, and he says, you are those who have stood by me in my trials, and I confer on you a kingdom, just as my Father conferred one on me, so that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Jesus is going to rule with his bride or his church. And so you see that relationship there, the sun and the moon. The sun rules during the day, the moon rules at night. Jesus did tell his disciples that they were going to rule with them, and he conferred the kingdom upon them at that time as well, okay? So not only do we have a promise that we're going to rule into eternity, but he actually gave authority to his church to rule now. As he said to Peter, he said, upon this rock I build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Okay, so it is a ruling authority. Psalm 89, 35 through 37 is going to give us the key to unlock the meaning of what the moon represents. It says, once for all, I have sworn by my holiness, and I will not lie to David, that his line will continue forever and his throne endure before me like the sun. It will be established forever like the moon, the faithful witness in the sky. Now, I want to point out that this prophecy talks about a throne enduring forever like the sun and the moon. But at some point, we won't need the sun and the moon because we have God. So understand, he's pointing to something greater than the physical sun and the moon here. Okay. But it does say it will be established forever like the moon, the faithful witness to the sky. So what does the Bible say? The sun is a bridegroom. It also specifically says Jesus was the rising sun in Zechariah's prophecy. But it says the moon is a witness, a faithful witness in the sky. Now, let me read some scriptures to you about what God says about his people. John 1, 6 through 9, it says, there came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a what? Witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. So he said he was not the light himself, but he gave witness. He became a witness of the light, the true light that was coming into the world to give light to everyone. So understand, the source of light was Jesus Christ. Now you can see here, okay, the faithful witness in the sky is the moon. The Bible says that we are going to be Christ's witnesses. But you see how this works. The moon is not a source of light. Okay, so when it says John was not the light himself, that applies to all of us. We don't have light in and of ourselves without God. But when God comes into the world to give light to all men, we are the reflection of his glory. Okay, and so just like the moon reflects the light of the sun, it governs the night, because even though you can't see that the sun's there, that's nighttime, okay? And that's where we are right now, you guys. Jesus Christ is sitting at the right hand of the Father. He's gone up. He said, I'm going where no one can see me. You can't go where I'm going, right? So that's what happens when the earth turns around and we are facing away from the sun. You cannot see the sun. So what is the evidence or the witness that the sun still exists? What is that witness? It's the moon. It's a lesser light because it is reflecting the source, which is the sun. But it is the evidence. When you can't see any other evidence of the fact that the sun is there, you know that the sun is there because the reflection of its light is coming off of the moon. That is the faithful witness. It is a witness to the fact that the sun is there and that that light is still exists. You can't see it. It's on the other side. We're facing away from it. But it has to exist, because if it didn't exist, there would be no light in the world. The moon would have no light because it's not a source. So that is evidence for the world. And it is also the way that the earth is governed, because it says that God gave these lights in the night to separate the light from the darkness. Okay, so it also acts as a judgment. It acts as a judge, because the way that people react to light, God judges their heart by how they react to light. The Bible says that the light came into the world, that was Jesus Christ, but the world did not receive him. They didn't love him because their hearts were evil, and the darkness hated the light and didn't understand it. Okay, so when people are evil and they want to hold on to their evil, they go and hide in the darkness. Okay, so it separates the light from the darkness. You understand that? And those who want to repent of their evil ways, they run to the voice of Jesus Christ. They run to the light. They're attracted to the light. Even though they're going to see everything that's wrong with them, they have a promise that they're going to be cleaned up and they're going to be made righteous. And that's what they're attracted to. That's what they want. So it serves as a judgment. So you understand why this is a governing force, okay? Whether you're talking about the sun or the moon, because of the fact that it's light. These are both governing entities. Okay, so I'm going to read to you some more things that tell us that we are God's witnesses. Acts 1:8 says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Acts 5:29 through 32 says, Peter and the other apostles replied, we must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus from the dead, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him to his own right hand as a prince and savior, that he might give repentance and forgiveness of sins to Israel. We are witnesses of these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him. So we see that the disciples again are saying that they are witnesses. Luke 21:12-14, Jesus said, but before all this, they will lay hands on you and persecute you. They will deliver you into synagogues and prisons, and you will be brought before kings and governors, and all on account of my name. This will result in your being witnesses to them. And again, Luke 24:46-48, he told them, this is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. So over and over, God says that we are the witnesses of the rising sun, which is Jesus Christ. We are the witness of the fact that he died, that he is raised from the dead, that he is now alive. We know that because we know him and we can see him. God has given us sight to know the Son of God and to know God. So that which the world cannot see, that the world looks around and says, oh, I don't have any evidence. I don't know that God exists. We know that he exists because he is in our hearts, because he lives inside of us. But that glory and the fact that his character reflects off of our lives, that's a reflection of his glory. And that's the evidence that the world needs, that the sun does rule and that the sun is getting ready to dawn, that the rule of the Messiah is quickly coming. You know, if you see that the moon is shining, that the sun is not far behind. That is the testimony that we have the responsibility to bear to the earth. Okay, so you see this. We've used scripture to show that the sun is Jesus, that the moon is a faithful witness in the sky that governs with the sun. That is the church. Okay, the people of God, that's the church. And you can see in their relationship the way that they relate to each other, right? We are not the light. He is greater than we are. But we do give light to the world by reflecting his glory. So here we go. God's secret wisdom. John 14:30-31 says, I will not speak with you much longer, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold on me, but the world must learn that I love the Father and that I do exactly what my Father has commanded me. God has a secret weapon, you guys. And Jesus understood that secret weapon. That was God's wisdom. Jesus Christ defeated the powers of the enemy through this secret wisdom. We're going to see that's what God is revealing in these end times, not only to the people on the earth, but to all of the authorities in the heavenly realms. And remember, this is the final battle we're talking about. So, you know, the book of Revelation, it shows us the culmination of all these things, that evil is coming into full bloom. It says it's harvest time, right? So everything's coming into full bloom and the sons of the kingdom are coming into full bloom. Everybody's looking and watching to see, okay, what's going to prevail? 1 Corinthians 2:6-8 says, "We do, however, speak a message of wisdom among the mature, but not the wisdom of this age or the rulers of this age who are coming to nothing. No, we speak of God's secret wisdom, a wisdom that's been hidden, that God destined for our glory before time began. None of the rulers of this age understood it, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory." You see, when they crucified Jesus, they were playing right into God's hand. According to God's secret wisdom, he understood how you overcome evil. You don't overcome evil with evil. Overcome evil with good. You treat your enemies well. You don't allow the evil to infect your heart. That's the whole secret. And what is being played out is that, you know, even if evil does its best to destroy you, if you don't allow the evil itself, the sin, to infect your heart, then at the end of the day, there's going to be a resurrection. So even if Satan does his worst to you, just like he did to Jesus Christ, there's nothing that he's going to be able to do to defeat you if you shun the sin. That is God's secret wisdom. That's his plan. If they would have understood it, they wouldn't have crucified Jesus, because they were beat, hands down. Satan gave him his best shot. Death, right? He tried to tempt him with sin, and he couldn't infect Jesus with sin because Jesus wasn't tempted by the things that Satan offered him, all the kingdoms of the world and everything. He wasn't tempted by that because Jesus loved God and he wanted to obey God. He didn't want those things of the world. And he wasn't intimidated when Satan threatened him and carried out those threats when he was crucified, right? But Jesus, by obeying God's secret wisdom, although it didn't seem to make sense, it's like, how am I going to establish a kingdom by allowing myself to be killed? Well, this is the secret. It's right here in 1 Corinthians 15:35-44. Jesus talks about it too, but I'm going to read it to you. Okay. It says, "But someone may ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body will they come? How foolish. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. When you sow, you do not plant the body that will be, but just a seed, perhaps of wheat or of something else. But God gives it a body as he has determined. And to each kind of seed, he gives its own body. So it will be with the resurrection of the dead. The body that is sown is perishable. It is raised imperishable. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body." Okay, so what did Jesus say up here? He said, "I will not speak with you much longer, for the prince of this world is coming. He has no hold on me, but the world must learn that I love the Father and that I do exactly what my Father has commanded me." The Father required that Jesus lay down his life, be sown in the ground like a seed. But the secret wisdom of God is that you're not going to stay there. There's a resurrection from the dead. And when you are raised, what you were sown in is dishonor and shame and pain. And the body that is sown is perishable. What is raised is imperishable and glorious and perfect. This is the wisdom of God. If Satan would have understood what was going to happen, if he would have known that Jesus was going to go down and get the keys to hell, death, he's got all the keys. He went down and he made a public spectacle of the powers of this world, according to the scriptures, right? So Satan didn't know that was going to happen, but still he hasn't learned his lesson. So he comes threatening us with the same thing and with the same old game plan. Oh, well, if you won't obey me, I'll just kill you. Well, guess what? As long as you don't allow the hate to infect you, and as long as you continue to love Jesus Christ, fear Jesus Christ and God our Father, and do what God wants you to do, you're going to have victory in the end. That's the secret wisdom of God. And that is what he's putting on display here in these end times. That's what Jesus came to teach the world. I want you to notice that. He said, "Satan has no hold on me, but the world must learn." See, he came to be our teacher, to show us how to do it. He came to be our rabbi. That's why he said, don't call anybody else rabbi. You have one rabbi. That's the Christ. I'm your teacher. I'm going to show you how to do it. And this is what the world must learn, that I do what my Father wants me to do. He gave us the pattern that we could follow, which is that we are going to also do the same thing, lay down our lives, and then we are going to be raised in glory. I do want to explain to you why it says that the moon will be turned to blood, okay? It tells us why, okay? Because remember, the moon is the faithful witness in the sky. We as the church are the witness of Jesus Christ. As the bride of Christ, we're a reflection of the glory of our husband, Jesus Christ. We emulate his ministry by following in his footsteps. We take up our cross. Jesus didn't just take up the cross so that we could, you know, be fat and happy and wealthy and get everything we want in this life. He said, no, you got to do the same thing. If anyone loves me, he will take up his cross daily, deny himself and follow me. So we got to follow that example. We got to do it too. Through this obedience, God will display the wisdom that will defeat Satan. Ephesians 3:10-11, very important scripture, says his intent, God's intent, was that now through the church, the manifold wisdom of God should be made known to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms, according to his eternal purpose, which he accomplished in Christ Jesus our Lord. Okay, so he is showing something to the rulers and authorities in the heavenly realms. He's showing that nothing can beat his wisdom. Now, everybody already knows that Jesus beat Satan, but you know, hey, there wasn't a big question, really. Think about this, you guys. There wasn't a big question about whether or not Satan could defeat God. Jesus came so that we could learn how to do it, because it is through us that he is going to show his manifold wisdom and the fact that not only can God not be corrupted in the end, but also his people, his children, are going to have victory as well. Now, why does he do this? I'm gonna show this to you, okay? God has chosen to use the church to put Jesus' enemies under his feet. Acts 2:34b-35 says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. And that's where Jesus is now. So, you know, God still has enemies and they still have to be defeated. What is still yet to be shown. Yes, we know that Satan couldn't corrupt Jesus. Okay, Jesus was sinless, right? But the big question is, how is God going to redeem these people? Because humankind did fall into sin. Their hearts have always been wicked, though God has given them forgiveness and mercy over and over. But see, God said, see, I am doing a new thing. Now it springs up before you. Do you not see it? Okay, he said that he is going to give his people a new heart. That's a prophecy. And that there is going to be victory. You read about Israel's history, you understand that people have a habit of going back to their sin, back to their sin. So everybody's standing around going, okay, how is there really any way to beat this? I mean, people are wicked, right? Is there any way that there's going to be victory? Yes, there is. And that is why God said, I'm going to make your enemies a footstool for your feet. But how's he going to do it? Matthew 16:18-19 tells us he's going to do it through the church. It says, and I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So the gates of hell will not stand against who? Well, we know that Jesus has the keys, right? Who does Jesus say the gates of hell will not stand against? Us, the church. We're going to beat Satan, you guys. We are going to be God's victory, and he's going to display his victory through us. Isn't that amazing? Now, why does he do this? Because God likes to use the weak things, you guys. That's the wisdom of God. God's wife was his weakness. Right? God's wife is his people. All throughout the Old Testament, he calls his people his wife. We are the bride of Jesus Christ, okay? And the Bible says that the wife is the weaker partner, although it says that we are co-heirs, right, with our husbands, but that we are the weaker partners, and that's why the husband should treat their wives gently. But God's wife was his weakness. Understand, God put humankind on this earth, and humankind fell into sin. God is holy. God doesn't have any sin in him. He doesn't have any shadow of turning, okay, in him. There's no darkness in him at all. God is light. In him, there is no darkness. But in his people were able to be deceived. And we see a picture of this with Adam and Eve in 1 Timothy 2:14. It says, and Adam was not the one deceived. It was the woman who was deceived and became a sinner. Well, the Bible says that Jesus is like the second Adam. It says that we're like his Eve. You know, Paul compares the church to Eve. He says, I'm afraid that you, I don't want you to be deceived like Eve was. Okay, so he makes that comparison. We are the bride of Christ. So the whole question is, are we just going to repeat this pattern again? Or is there going to be victory? Is this Eve, this second Eve, this bride of Christ, is she going to be able to beat the enemy? Or is she going to be deceived over and over and over again? We already know Adam wasn't the one deceived. Okay, he was talking about, really talking about Jesus, because all of humankind fell. Adam sinned too, right? All of humankind has been deceived. So he's pointing us to something greater here. Do you understand that? Everybody knows that God's not going to be deceived, but what about the girl? How is she ever going to have victory? Well, that's why he's going to display his wisdom through the church. Not just through his son, but he's going to show he is going to put Satan under the church's feet. And you guys, that's why God said that he would put enmity between the serpent and the woman. That's why, you guys, because the woman's the one that defeats him. Through Jesus Christ, that's where we get our power. But it's God's good pleasure to use the weak things. I'm going to read this to you in 1 Corinthians 1:27. It says, but God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong. This is his plan. He's going to use us, you and me, us imperfect human beings. He's going to use us to display his perfect wisdom. That's the plan, you guys. And Revelation tells us the key as to how the saints overcome Satan's kingdom. Now, this is the key. You guys have got to remember, have ears to hear this, okay? Because your flesh isn't going to want to hear it. Revelation 12, 10b through 11 says, for the accuser of our brothers who accuses them before our God day and night has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. This is how we do it. We do it by the blood of the Lamb, because through the blood of the Lamb, we have forgiveness of our sins and we are given life, the life of God. We are reconciled to God through the blood of the Lamb. And then we have the power of God within us and through the word of our testimony. Okay. That is, we testify of the light, just like John did. Even though we're not the light, we testify of him. We are the faithful witness in the sky. We are the moon. We testify of his glory. So first of all, through the word of their testimony, they told the truth. They told about Jesus, and it says that they did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. So what do you see? The moon is shining, and right now the moon is shining. But what is prophesied is going to happen? Two things are going to happen. First, the moon's going to turn to blood, and then the sun and the moon will both go completely dark. Now, when the sun and the moon go completely dark, it tells us when that happens in Isaiah 13, 9 through 13. It says, see, the day of the Lord is coming, a cruel day with wrath and fierce anger to make the land desolate and destroy the sinners within it. The stars of heaven and their constellations will not show their light. The rising sun, Jesus, right? According to that prophecy, the rising sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. I will punish the world for its evil, the wicked for their sins. I will put an end to the arrogance of the haughty and will humble the pride of the ruthless. I will make them scarcer than pure gold or more rare than the gold of Ophir. Therefore, I will make the heavens tremble and the earth will shake from its place at the wrath of the Lord Almighty at the day of his burning anger. Okay, you guys. Do you understand what happens here? The final witness of the church. First of all, the witness of the church is that we give testimony. We overcome the evil one. How? Through the blood of the Lamb, the word of our testimony, and we do not shrink, love our lives so much that we shrink from death. I'm going to show you Revelation 6, 9 through 17. When he opened the fifth seal, I saw under the altar the souls of those who had been slain because of the word of God and the testimony they had maintained. They called out in a loud voice, how long, sovereign Lord, holy and true, until you judge the inhabitants of the earth and avenge our blood? Then each of them was given a white robe, and they were told to wait a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and brothers who were to be killed as they had been was completed. I watched as he opened the sixth seal. There was a great earthquake. The sun turned black like sackcloth made of goat hair, and the whole moon turned blood red, and the stars in the sky fell to the earth as late figs dropped from a fig tree when shaken by a strong wind. The sky receded like a scroll rolling up, and every mountain and island was removed from its place. So here, you guys, you see this picture he's shown us. The martyrs are increasing. The number of them up in heaven is increasing. And they're saying, how long, O God, before you pour out your wrath on the wicked who've done this to us? And he says, just a little longer until your number is completed. So you see that what is happening on the earth, the saints are being martyred. They're being killed. Revelation 13, 5 through 10. It says, this is God's plan, okay, you guys? It says, the beast was given a mouth to utter proud words and blasphemies and to exercise his authority for 42 months. He opened his mouth to blaspheme God and to slander his name and his dwelling place and those who live in heaven. He was given power to make war against the saints and to conquer them. Did you hear that? This is God's plan. Now, a lot of your prophecy teachers aren't going to teach you guys this. But this is how God's going to display his wisdom, you guys. He's going to give Satan power to conquer the saints. That's why you see the martyrs, the number of martyrs increasing. And then as soon as it's completed, it says the sixth seal is opened. There's a great earthquake and the whole moon turns blood red. The sun goes dark and the whole moon turns blood red. So the moon is a faithful witness in the sky and the final witness is her blood. That's what the scripture says is going to happen. God is going to give Satan the ability to conquer the saints. And it says he was given authority over every tribe, people, language, and tongue. Talking about the beast All inhabitants of the earth will worship the beast, all whose names have not been written in the book of life belonging to the Lamb that was slain from the creation of the world. He who has an ear, let him hear. If anyone is to go into captivity he will go. If anyone is to be killed with the sword he will be killed. This calls for patient endurance and faithfulness on the part of the saints. You guys, this is God's plan, just like the plan with Jesus. It is his secret wisdom. Okay, and if Satan understood it, then he wouldn't go through with the plan. He wouldn't play right into God's hands, but he's going to do it again and again. That's all he can do is just kill what doesn't obey him. He doesn't have the secret of wisdom of God. But God is going to display his glory through us, the church. Okay, so here you go, you guys. I want to point out to you, this may not be obvious to you, but it says that there's going to be a time the rising sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light. Okay, so even though the sun is rising, right? What happens right before that dawn breaks is great darkness on the world because the light of the sun goes dark. Now, understand, the moon doesn't have any light of its own. So when the light of the sun goes dark, the moon also goes dark. But right before it goes dark, what is it? What is the final witness? It turns blood red, according to the other scriptures. This is the blood of the saints, you guys. And do you notice it says the whole moon will turn blood red? Okay, Jesus said, he prophesied that you will be hated by all nations, okay? All nations at the time of the end. Now, we've had persecution of the saints going on all throughout history since the time of Jesus Christ. But at the end, it says that, you know, these martyrs are going to be up there in heaven and their number is going to be increasing. And there comes a time when their number is complete, okay? And then we see this picture of that happening right afterwards when the sun goes dark and the moon is turned to blood. And then it says that the time comes when the moon doesn't give its light and there is no light. It is all darkness on the earth. It's the darkness is so bad on the earth. When that witness goes dark, it says that men will gnash their teeth and gnash their tongues because of the great distress of those days and of the great darkness that comes on the earth. It's going to be a horrible time. That's the wrath of the Lord, you guys. When that witness is extinguished, that's what he's talking about. Jesus said, then you will be handed over to be persecuted and put to death, and you will be hated by all nations because of me. At that time, many will turn from the faith and will betray and hate each other, and many false prophets will appear and deceive many people. Because of the increase of wickedness, the love of most will grow cold, but he who stands firm to the end will be saved. So the whole moon's going to turn blood red because in the end times, if you don't take the mark of the beast, if you do not conform to Satan's kingdom, God gave him power to overcome the saints. If you're a saint, you're going to be conquered. That's the plan. TikTok TV is funded exclusively by viewers like you. If you would like to make a donation online, you can do so at www.tiktok.tv, or you can send your donation to TikTok Ministries, P.O. Box 155155, Irving, Texas 75015.